It's another home energy update video, this time covering the month of March 2022. We will look at what we generated from our solar panels, how our Tesla Powerwall 2 fared, charging of our two EVs and heating our hot water from surplus solar, plus our electric and gas bills for the month. Also, I'll share the performance from the first 17 days output from the wind turbine we part own in Windy Wales via Ripple Energy. So stay tuned. Hi, John here, and welcome. Let's get straight into it, shall we? And in case you missed the intro, stay to the end of the video for the wind turbine stats and data update, which is very interesting. The graphic on screen, which you can pause the video and review if you want to, is all of our components in our system. Alternatively, have a look at the description down below in the video, as there's a complete list of all our components and specifications there too. So here's our solar generation for the month. 647 units from our south-southwest facing 6.34 kilowatt array. We beat our 2021 March total, and with two more good days, we would have equaled our 2020 total, only sort of 48 units behind that total. And just have a look at that average daily solar for the month of March 2020 and March 2022. 21 units in March 2022 and 22 units in March 2020, so not that far behind. Our total generation figure for the period divided by the size of our solar array is 647 units for the period divided by 6.4 worth of panels, works out at 100 kilowatt hours per kilowatt of panel. So how did you all get on? And drop your totals in the comments down below in the time-honoured tradition. Let's have a look at the split, shall we, for both arrays. So our 4 kilowatt array produced 402 units, and the newer 2.34 array produced 245 units. A very similar split to March 2020 totals, as you can see there. Let's have a look at the Powerwall contribution and the solar into our self-power. We've been in cost-saving mode with the Powerwall 2, and with solar and the Powerwall contributions, we were 63% self-powered for the month, which is up from February, as you would obviously expect. And you can see the impact that solar has had on that self-powered percentage. Comparing it with February, it's almost doubled, so 32% versus 18%. So that's all good news. PV yearly totals. Let's have a look at the month of March through the years. So this is March through the ages. So March 2022 stacks up nicely against March 2021 and March 2020. As you can see there, March 2021 was really a poor month in terms of this data set for solar. So we'll look at our Powerwall in and out. The round trip efficiency for the Powerwall for the month was 86%. That means that we managed to extract 86% of what we put into the battery. With the battery systems, there are always losses as you convert in and out. The norm for the Powerwall is around 90%, 89-90%. So we're very close to that. We put 426 units in and used 365 units over the course of the month. This chart looks at the day by day for the month and gives you a little bit more detail on what's happening. If you're familiar with this chart, you'll know the house usage is shown in blue. The peaks there in blue are typically when we have charged one of the EVs. And again, if you're a regular, we'll also run of our glass kilns every day during the off-peak period, which adds 6 units to the daily total. And when the sun is out, we'll run one of the kilns during the day to get that firing for free from solar surplus. Solar generation shown in yellow is rather lost at the start of the month and then starts to build as the month progresses. Conversely, as the solar improves, then the red bars, which is the grid bill, reduces. So it's nice to see that contrast happening there. We did a little bit more energy escape back to the grid as export this month, which is shown in orange. We had the biggest single export day was 4.8 units on the 28th of March, 28th of the month. It's actually interesting to look at the days from the 19th through to the 26th, where we had a little pull from the grid, high house usage and high solar production. You can visually see the benefit of having solar panels and a home storage battery there. That's really a good showcase for having that technology of self-generation at home. We scroll down and look at the overall totals. This is our four data sets that we've just looked at in the day by day. Again, house usage shown in blue is the key one. So a total of 1239.9 units versus our solar production of 646.9 or 647. And the delta was provided by the grid at 651.1 units with 47 seeping back to the grid. So let's have a look at those grid charts in a bit more detail. So this is our average daily house usage and our average daily grid usage over the preceding months. Not surprising, our average daily house usage was down at 40 units, that's the blue line, and our average daily pull from the grid also took a plunge down to 21 units, which is the red line. Almost a 50% reduction on February's grid usage. As mentioned a couple of charts ago, we sent 47 units back to the grid of excess solar generation. I really like to keep on top of that, to be honest, and have as little as possible going back and use it on site. Scrolling down to what we consumed 650 units from the grid. Again, a big drop compared to February. And again, this should start to fall away even more now as we get more into spring and summer, fingers crossed. I've turned off our scheduled timer for the My Energy app for heating our hot water from the cheap rate overnight electricity. We can almost guarantee now there's enough excess solar to heat our hot water via the eddy on a daily basis. We probably use about 2 kilowatts, 2.5 units a day to heat our hot water, keep it hot. Actually, that's a really nice segue into the eddy stats. So yes, my rehearsals paid off. Let's have a look at the eddy stats then. So the My Energy eddy heats our hot water from surplus solar. The eddy has diverted 25 units of solar generation to heat our hot water for the month. Running totals for the eddy, as you can see there, 48 for the year and 870 since installation. And the running costs, well, the running savings, beg your pardon, are calculated at £63.05. Based on our cheap rate electricity of 5.5 pence per unit. Moving on to the cars. The Tesla Model 3 covered 349 miles during the month, bringing its overall total to 18,420. No issues or problems with the car. We didn't do any public charging sessions with the Tesla in March. All done home charging, where we added 101.91 units. 48% of our total charge for the month came from sunshine, which was good, with the remaining 111.46 units coming from the grid. Again, this energy would have been at the off-peak Octopus Energy Go Faster tariff of 5.5 pence per kilowatt hour per unit. The little Zoe covered 415 miles, so we're using that more than the Tesla at the moment, it would seem. And it now has a total mileage of 26,242 miles. No issues or problems to report with the car. And we're averaging around 5 kilowatt hours per mile in the car, which in the short journeys that it does, which is actually very impressive because it has been quite cold as well. And yeah, just look at that speed and anticipation score too. You get that flash up on the screen when you power off the car. So it'll give you a quick review of how you're getting on. It's an accumulative figure rather than for that particular drive. But I'm not sure what you have to do to get the perfect score of 100, because that is sort of very gentle driving, very little acceleration, lots of regen. And 50 mile an hour in maximum speed. So Perhaps I have to go everywhere 40. Okay, so in the spreadsheet there you can see the monthly running costs for both cars, which was basically peanuts in terms of pounds per mile. And that will get cheaper with more sunshine and home charging from excess solar. We've just had in today, as I record this video, our gas and electric bill. So let's just have a look at those. So here's our electric bill, which covers from the March the 5th through to April the 4th inclusive, which is 31 days. Total usage was 568.5 units. Just in case you're linking back to what I said earlier about units from the grid, and that was taken from the Tesla app and is for the month of March, so March 1st to the 31st. But our electricity bill is from the 5th of March to the 4th of April, so it just goes over. So it's not a like-for-like comparison, which is why the unit total is slightly different, just in case you're thinking I'm trying to pull a fast one. Honest Gov, I'm not. So total usage, 568.5 units. Of that, 542.8 units were at the off-peak rate of 5.24, which works out at £28.43, and just 25 units, or 25.7, was at the more expensive 14.6. I say more expensive, it's actually cheap now based on the current price of electricity. And that worked out at £3.74. Including the VAT and standing charge, our bill for the month was £41.54. Our gas bill, let's have a look at that. That runs again from the 5th of March to the 4th of April inclusive, so same time period for 31 days. There was a price increase there, so I've actually also got two bills if you like. They're split over the two tariffs. So the first bit is from the 5th of March to the 1st of April inclusive, and that was 114 metres of cubed of gas, which is equivalent to 1,278 units of electricity at 3.58 pence, works out at £45.76. If you include the VAT and standing charge on that, it comes in at £54.73. And then the second bit of the bill on the higher rate is from the 2nd of April to the 4th of April inclusive, where we used 18 cubic metres of gas, which is equivalent to 202 units of electricity. And that's at the more expensive rate of 6.93 pence per kilowatt hour or per unit. So that's £14.04. Including the VAT and standing charge comes out at £15.56, giving us a total bill for the month of £111.83 for gas and electricity combined and covering everything. I've already sort of referenced the increasing gas price there. So our cheap rate electricity is now cheaper than gas. We've already been heating our hot water from electric rather than gas, as it's more efficient. You know, obviously electricity is 100% efficient, whereas gas, well, certainly our gas boiler is probably 70% efficient, with losses on the way. So it always has been more efficient to heat it via the immersion heater and either surplus solar or the cheap rate overnight electricity price. But it's certainly now cheaper, and gas prices are only going to go one way in the future. There's bound to be another rise in October and the second energy review that's going to happen. So two reviews in a year. We certainly will be getting off gas as a household, but I don't know when it'll be. I suspect it probably won't be this year. That said, the heating season is almost over, so we won't be using much gas anyway, although we will be still paying the standing charge. So the new bit then, let's talk about wind power. So why did I invest in a wind farm? I wanted to expand my options for generating power. We didn't really have any sensible space for more solar PV, so that really was a bit of a non-starter. I toyed with getting an additional battery, but that didn't really seem like a sensible option, paying for more static battery power. You know, it would have been useful for half the year in the winter, but not that useful for the summer months, because we just wouldn't be able to use that extra power. It would just be stuck in the battery and we'd never use it between sundown and sun up. And I guess even more so because we've got two battery packs on wheels that we can't tap into currently, and we're really waiting for mainstream vehicle to house solution to come reality, which I suspect won't be too long. And before you all jump into the comments, I'm aware that there are some options out there. You know, the Hyundai Ioniq V2L, vehicle to load, the 3-pin plug option, but that's fairly limited. And then there's the options of using the CHAdeMO adapter, but again, it needs a specific model of EV to take advantage of that, and a specific charge converter. So, you know, currently they're all sort of fringe solutions rather than mainstream, in my opinion. So I wanted to generate rather than store power, and a technology that would work better in the winter when the solar production was poor and sketchier. So, you know, wind power seemed like a sensible option, as it works best in winter when it's typically windier here in the UK. And I came across Ripple Energy and decided to invest in their first cooperative wind farm ownership program in the UK, and that was back in July 2021. The first of the two wind farms I invested in went live on the 15th of March 2022 at 7 p.m. This is Craig Thaffer in Wales. Sorry if I've mispronounced that. And I purchased 1,158 watts for this particular wind turbine. And this is the data I've recorded so far. My portion has generated 96.26 units, and I have earned £9.14, which is credited automatically to my Octopus Energy account. And you know, this is the first of its type, so everyone is in a bit of a learning curve as we go along. The data and the dashboard is evolving on a weekly basis, and we're getting to see more and more data. But if anyone is interested to learn more about this, then I'll do a separate video and go into deeper dive. Just let me know in the comment section down below and I'll cover that and pick it up. Incidentally, if you're interested, here's my referral link, again, down in the description below. And if you decide to join, we both get £25 credit for spends over £1,000. And as with any investment, please do your own research before you decide to take the plunge. So yeah, there you go. That's it. Quick update. Any questions, dive down into the comments and I'll pick them up as usual. Please comment, like, share. All of those good actions help get this video shown to more people on YouTube, which helps my channel grow. Thanks for watching and I'll see you on the next video, which actually is coming up almost back on the back of this one. It's an update on the Tesla Powerwall and total costs of our system to date. We've basically spent 28 grand and I'll talk you through that. So yeah, that's coming soon. Enjoy. Take care. Bye.